All right, why don't we get started? Thank you all for coming to the Legislative Branch Capacity Working Group's latest meeting. For those of you who have not been here before, we got this launched this past spring. It's a project of New America. My co-director Lee Drutman's right here. And I'm Kevin Kosar of R Street Institute. Today's topic is Congress and technology. Does Congress have the technology it needs to govern? And we put together a panel who, you can see their tent cards. They are all working this angle in their own way, doing important stuff to move Congress to a 21st century platform. But I imagine they're going to explain that there's still a lot of work to be done. Before I go any further, I want to say thanks to Senator Moran's office. They were the ones who got us this room, in particular Trent. Great guy, been very helpful to us. We can't get these rooms without the congressional office stepping up and requesting them for us. So if any of you work for members and would be willing to help us out in the coming months to secure rooms, please shoot me a message or come up to me afterwards, because we need the help. Everybody, I've passed out hats. If anyone wants more hats for folks they know back in their offices or elsewhere, they're out there. You can pick them up on the way out. And let me offer, before we get to the panelists, my own little anecdote about the issue of Congress and technology. This past December, I had the pleasure of being called before a House subcommittee to discuss an issue about involving appropriations. And there were four of us sitting at the table, including a representative from the Data Coalition. And the question was put, can you tell us, you Kevin Kosar, you GAO, you Data Coalition, how much money the federal government collects in fees and then turns around and spends without the money being formally reappropriated? And there wasn't a soul on the panel who could answer the question. And what it came down to was, it looks like Treasury has those data, but there's no ready congressional interface to be able to look at it. It's like Congress has to go hat in hand to ask for it, if they think to ask for it at all. And for me, that really was an intense moment, because I mean, one of the most basic powers of Congress is the power of the purse. And here you had House Oversight and Government Reform Committee, committee whose charge is to oversee money, amongst other things, and they didn't know. And neither did we so-called experts know the answer to that question. It's data. The data are there. Why can't Congress get to them? Why is it so difficult? I don't know. But it's kind of hard to do oversight if you can't get your hands on the data. So with that, let me turn it over to the panel. We're going to go from your left to right. Each panelist will have about 10 minutes to introduce themselves and to answer the question, does Congress have the technology it needs, and perhaps comment on what's going well, what reforms have occurred, and what needs to be done. Beth?
Thanks, Kevin. My name is Christian Hainer. I'm the Policy Director for the Data Coalition. And yes, we were thrilled to testify alongside R Street at this December hearing with House Oversight. But we bill ourselves as the nation's only trade association focused specifically on propagating data standards across the federal and state governments. And what that means is we want to see the adoption of machine-readable, non-proprietary formats for information that federal agencies collect as well as create. So, can you hear me now? Okay. So briefly, I just want to talk to you about like two aspects of our agenda, the first being kind of our legislative agenda, specifically for laws and regs as open data, and then a little bit on kind of something I'm calling capacity building for Congress that fits more into what Kevin was talking about with access to federal information. But this past June at the Legislative Data Transparency Conference, House Speaker Ryan stated, "We're now working to go further and publish even more current and past documents in XML, machine readable format. I've asked our team to keep moving ahead by publishing all legislative measures in a standard format. That means enrolled measures, public laws, and statutes at large. We want this data to be as accessible as possible throughout the legislative cycle. I love that phrasing of data accessible throughout the legislative cycle. So our coalition, amongst some other coalitions, are backing three bills aimed at accomplishing those goals. The first being the Searchable Legislation Act, introduced last Congress by Amash of Michigan, and that would establish non-proprietary machine-readable data standards for the creation, transmission, and publication of congressional legislative branch agencies. This would include bulk download and electronically searchability features for bills, resolutions, orders, and votes. And this bill would expand kind of a lot of what the House has done, really codify that work, and also help the Senate kind of up their game as well. And then another bill that I want to focus on is the Statutes at Large Modernization Act. This one's key, introduced by Dave Bratt and Seth Moulton. But it would put all historical federal laws online in a machine-readable format, XML. And what that does is makes past laws Congress has passed really much more accessible. And not a lot of people understand the difference between the U.S. Code, which codifies and organizes by subject more all the laws of our country, versus the statutes at large, which is the kind of historical ordering of everything that Congress passes throughout its history. And the difference is that the U.S. Code kind of misses annually occurring measures like appropriations, and it doesn't include laws that were repealed or amended. So if you want to do like really intuitive historical analysis, you need to be able to, you know, peel back and get access to the statutes at large. So we want to open that portal. And we're already seeing Congress pass bills like the Taxpayers' Right to Know Act that would ask that all programs be mapped to the statutes. Well, that's really easy to say, but how are you going to get all that data? So if it's in machine-readable format, you could do that a lot easier. And then the last bill is a pretty simple one, but effective for allowing the public to really tap in. That would be Lisa Stefanik's Edit Act, and that would just introduce redlining to Congress.gov, so we could see visually in an intuitive manner how bills are changing from version to version. I think a lot of the frustration the public has with Congress is that they feel like they can't get the information they want, and it really is kind of an unintuitive process. It makes sense to us because we live and breathe it, but for someone just starting out, it can be kind of scary. So not to drone on, but the second part I want to talk about is one of our main priorities and kind of how the Data Coalition came to being, and that is the Data Act. Congress needs to really kind of envision like the technology aspect in terms of both building out systems for them to use and kind of pass their own bills, but also really focusing on kind of building out and fostering agency open data. Because if you're focusing on open data in a healthy manner, that means you have source systems that are accurate and timely updated, and that data is then accessible through APIs and formats. But the more Congress can assure that agency data, like financial information, is there and maintained, then it's easier to grab when you need to do analysis on it and avoid kind of layers and layers of systems and places you're storing it. So you need to think about kind of like this data lake approach. The more Congress can legally mandate and provide resources to the agencies through various authorizations of programs and make that expectation clear that you need to, you know, keep good records of your information, the easier it is for you to have hearings and actually do research on the federal government. So kind of getting into that Article 1 proclamation, power of the purse kind of argument. But just so you're aware, the Data Act passed in 2014, law mandates that OMB and Treasury creates a consistent, standardized data format for all federal agency finances as well as awards, so the contracts and grants. So this is the first time we're going to see the financial systems directly linked to the award side, which means that starting in May, when agencies have to report a single consolidated data set to Treasury to be published openly on usaspending.gov, first time in history we'll be able to map an appropriation through unobligated obligations to outlays and see which contractor or grantee gets it without having to do that matchmaking yourself. So, right, as a Data Coalition, we're encouraging Congress to take this seriously and to develop out the systems to match your workflow to that new data, so that when you're doing budget, appropriations, authorizations, oversight work, you have in your committees, in your personal office, tools for your staff to grab that information. Yes, it's going to be, you know, up on usaspending.gov, intuitive like visualizations, but what are you going to use to grab the raw data and make it work for you? And then lastly, We've been backing the Open Government Data Act, and this is an important general open data mandate for federal agencies. Public portals for information that they're storing, so you can compare in one spot all the agency data sets and figure out what you need. And then a mandate for all information that's collected or created by agencies to be in machine-readable, non-proprietary formats. That avoids data sets being locked behind vendor agreements with GSA, like the DUNS number, for identifying contractors and grantees. And it also avoids bulk downloadable zip files of PDFs that then, you know, you've got to print and retype into your own Excel spreadsheets or what have you. So those are kind of the laws that we're pushing, and I'd be happy to talk more about them. So thanks.
Hi everyone, good afternoon. I'm Daniel Schumann. I'm Policy Director at Demand Progress and co-founder of the Congressional Data Coalition. And I'm glad to see so many faces that I recognize in this room and more than a handful that I don't, so I'm looking forward to meeting you as well. So I come at the question of technology for Congress really from a legislative capacity perspective. Over the last 20 or 30 years, Congress has really cut back on its ability to perform its functions. And in the outside world, with businesses, what we've seen is that information technology has come in as a way, I'm going to move this mic so you can actually hear me, that IT has come in as a way to deal with the fact that we're getting rid of a lot of staff. So when you look on the business side, whether it's dealing with clients or constituents in the congressional context, or working on a lot of the legislative or business processes, technology has sort of come to the fore. But in Congress, we haven't really seen that. So what we're seeing on one side is 1,000 fewer committee staff in the House over the last 20 years, and not necessarily things that help replace that loss of capacity to perform its functions. So that's sort of that piece, that capacity piece, is incredibly important, but the way Congress functions, it doesn't usually think about things in that kind of way. It does think about things in sort of these three buckets, which are obvious to everybody in the room, right? It deals with it. How do I deal with my constituents? How do I do legislative work? And how do I do oversight? And a lot of the issues that we've all been working on for the last decade come down to like really simple questions. Someone says, well, why can't I see all the reports that agency said to Congress? Like, why isn't there a place for that? Or if I have, you know, this money that I'm appropriating, why can't I see it all the way down to like its final point of expenditure? You know, why can I track it through? That was 3 years of my life answering that question, which was the Data Act, right? Or the question about reports is the Access to Congressionally Mandated Reports Act, which I did not name, because I would have come up with a better acronym. But those are the kinds of questions that we spend a lot of time answering. And when it comes to sort of the internal operations of Congress, what we found are a couple things. One is that things only happen when there is bipartisan agreement. So we saw for a long time sort of the House and the Senate, Democrats and Republicans, not necessarily on the same page with respect to public access to legislative information. But once they came onto the same page, all of a sudden you saw a new Congress.gov replacing Thomas. You saw docs.house.gov, which is where all the information about committee documents and what's happening on the floor bill. Or you saw the development of rules.house.gov. Like, this is where you started to see this bipartisan agreement that sort of pushed the bureaucracy to start trying to solve these problems. And we've made a fair amount of progress. The other sort of factor in play here that we've seen is that changes on the outside lead to changes on the inside. So everybody knew that Thomas wasn't very good. GovTrack came into existence, a bunch of other sites came into existence, and that helped drive the process to some extent of thinking through what services and tools should be available. And you see that sort of story again and again and again as different like tools become online. You can go and do bill comparisons, right? So the ability to compare the text of bills has driven the development of some internal tools to try to do those kinds of things. And there's a great project right now that Committee on House Administration is pushing called the Amendment Impact Project, which would allow you to see how an amendment would change a bill in real time. And this all ties back to capacity. So if you want to do a bill comparison, I worked at CRS, so we did a bunch of these, right? If you want to be able to do that kind of thing, you can waste a bunch of time like doing that basic level work, or there can be a button that you can push that does it for you, right? This is not the kind of thing that a human being needs to do. If you're trying to compare two roll call votes. You shouldn't have some intern spend an hour doing that, right? That's crazy. Joe Carmel built a system that will do that comparison for you in 5 seconds and make it available to you as a structured data file. If you want to see what's happening on the floor, you shouldn't have to spend $1,000 a year to pay for Congressional Quarterly. That data should, in fact, be available to you, and in fact, now it is. So internal developments of this push that we're seeing, particularly in the House and to a lesser extent in the Senate, combined with outside groups helping to shine the way to some extent, combined with rethinking the way Congress itself functions. And I'll just sort of close with two thoughts. One is that Congress is incredibly decentralized in the way that it functions. The committees do things differently. The House and the Senate do things differently. The Library of Congress doesn't do things the same way GPO does things. It doesn't do things the same way CPO does, and so on and so forth, right? There is a lot of people doing things in very different ways. We have seen some coordination coming out through the Bulk Data Task Force to try to help make everybody sort of talk to each other a little bit better. But we're at the point, I think, for the next step. There needs to be some better way to coordinate and push forward the technological development capacity that engages with outside groups, but that also looks at Congress sort of writ large, including the legislative support offices and agencies. And the second is, this technology development work is important, but ultimately what it comes back to is, where is Congress in its capacity? Where is it suffering the greatest problems? Why is it spending so much time dealing with constituent requests in a way that is data entry as opposed to solving problems? Why is it spending so much time trying to keep track of letters sent to agencies when there should be an automated tool to do so? Like, these kinds of questions are resolvable by small amounts of technology investment. And what we've seen on the executive side with the development of 18F is a mechanism to try to resolve this for federal agencies. We need to be thinking about structures to do this inside the legislative branch. I hope we can talk about this more, and hopefully if I did it right, I teed you up perfectly.
Thank you.
Does this one work?
Yeah. I'm bringing this over as well.
Does this work?
Yeah. Awesome. Cool. I'm Meg Daugherty with the Open Gov Foundation. Most of you in this room probably know us by now, but we were born out of the Oversight Committee back in 2013 when we built a public engagement tool for staff to collect feedback on bills that were happening in Congress. Since then, we've been really at the core of building the technologies to solve these structural problems, mostly on the outside, but working directly with Congress and also on the state and local level. So I'm happy to be here today. I think we've learned a lot from working in the state and local level that have yet to be tapped into in Congress. And that's from working with the legislative branch and the opportunities that exist with the Bulk Legislative Task Force and having all open data available. That doesn't exist yet in most places in the state and local level. So being able to bridge both of those things is an exciting moment for us at the Open Gov Foundation. Part of what I'm excited to be here about today is we've done a lot of research and focus groups with staff about these exact problems about tech capacity in Congress. One quote I wanted to share with you guys is, when asked a staffer, does Congress have the tech capacity it needs to function? The answer was, it is messed up that every office has a different website, different policies, different everything. I can only imagine the experience for constituents. So not only are we facing these problems internally, but we're also having an impact not in the most positive way for our constituents. So the tools that we're building today can serve the inside and the outside. Building off of Daniel's point, some of the great advances that we've had with Congress.gov and the Bulk Legislative Task Force have all led us to building these really amazing tools on the outside using the open data that exists. And continuing to amplify these efforts to solving these structural problems. Again, it's looking at the 18F and the Technological Transformation Service, the TTS. That's also another good way for us to bring our solutions into Congress. So I'm excited to hear what you guys think on what changes we can make, and I'm excited to be here. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Sasha Moss. I'm a technology policy fellow at the R Street Institute. I work with Kevin. And when I was composing my notes for today, I just kind of wanted to break it down to, I guess, 12-year-old speak, or I would say my mother can understand it at 65. So I have buckets like good stuff, bad stuff, private parties doing good stuff for government transparency, and then staff stuff, as well as my recommendations. And I think I'm going to approach this in more like a staff point of view, because I am a former staffer, and I have dealt with a lot of the issues that folk like us try to fix. And our street's very lucky. Well, we have a staff of many former Hill staffers, Demand Progress is a similar way, so OpenGov, and Data Coalition. And while we like to make fun of members for not being very technological savvy, there's some good quotes like net neutrality is Obamacare for the internet, or internet's just a series of tubes, and we like to mock them on The Daily Show, and it's a great time for all of us involved. There are a lot more serious issues at hand and how these decisions, how these statements are being made. And that goes down to the staff that they have. Due to staff being paid quite poorly and staff payments going down yearly, you have to think an MRA allots for about 18 staffers per office, give or take. Where's all the money going? Where is the staff? Who runs this? How are the 26-year-olds making these really big decisions, especially when it comes to technology? I happen to work for a really technological savvy office, so we had some of the best new tech available to use and use well. But what we also found in the office I used to work for was third-party intermediaries like Twitter and Facebook are really great ways of engaging with constituents. And I think that's mildly problematic. While someone can tweet at their congressman saying, I don't like this and I need to change it, it's Twitter, it's a public forum. And a really great example on that for my personal experience was a constituent had tweeted at my former boss, saying that he had called into the office, the staffer couldn't answer his question. He was really, really upset, and he was not going to vote for him in the primary. End of story. Tweeted that all out, 140 characters. It was just like, whoa. So the congressman had read this tweet, and then he tweeted right back at him going, here's the line to my office. Please call, and you'll speak with legislative staffer. Within an hour, the constituent got to speak with the legislative director of the office. All the questions were answered, and he then tweeted back at the congressman saying he would vote from the primary, get all his friends to vote for him, and he's basically the best congressman ever. So that's an example of technology has served transparent and communicational basis for members, but there's a lot of interesting things also going on the Hill. There are a lot of caucuses that have been started. There's a STEM caucus. There's the Congressional Open Source Technology Caucus. There are various intellectual property caucuses, the Trade Secrets Caucus, I believe it's called. I can't even reel off the top of my head. There are so many. But what do these caucuses actually do, and how many of them are actually effective? The Open Source Technology Caucus, I know, is incredibly effective due to the help of Open Government Foundation and trying to host hackathons, create more awareness of how we can bring in hacktivists and private parties to solve questions and problems that are laid in Congress. But why do we have to go to the outside when we're looking at an internal problem? How did we get here? Why did it take until 1979 for the floor to be televised in C-SPAN and 1986 for the Senate? Why have we waited so long for a more transparent Congress? And why aren't we working these problems from the inside and then going out instead of going to third parties to try to solve our problem for us? And again, it goes down to staffing. If you don't hire the best staff to do these positions and pay them well enough, you're not going to get the answers you want. If you work on a peerage system, much of the Hill does, if you intern, you become a staff assistant, then become an LC, then become an LA, then you're an LD, and before you know it, you're a chief. But does that mean you should be excluding outside individuals with law degrees or technological expertise? Does that mean we shouldn't be engaging with outside individuals who are looking to get in to try and to help the congressional offices? And oftentimes this is the case. So another private entity that's kind of come in and done some really great work is Tech Congress, and they're represented today. And they're trying to get technologists here on the Hill to assist members and committee staff to solve these really difficult problems. We have also Madison's OpenGov, Madison's legislative data tracker. That's great. Every CRS report from Congressional Data Coalition is another great example of a private group coming in and trying to create a more transparent government. But yet our government's still running on really old Dell computers, and the Yahoo email breach could entirely shut down the email services as we know it. This was back in March. And I think you guys might have heard the big uproar that a lot of emails were going to spam and no one was receiving anything. And I think the most important factor for staffers was they could not access Cloakroom, the app. And that was a huge deal. And Ted Henderson went on a massive tirade. because we had a hack on Congress and that possibly shouldn't have happened. We should have better cybersecurity. The fact that staffers don't understand how Signal works and that EFF had to come to the Hill about a month ago and say, you should probably look into this app. It's a full encrypted technology. Why aren't you using that? Why are you just sending GChats? Why are you using regular text message for very sensitive data that you want to transfer information back and forth from your staffers to your congressmen? And that's problematic that we had to rely so heavily on the outside. And while someone on the outside, I'm kind of excited by that fact because it keeps me in, I have work, I have a job, I get paid, my rent gets paid. But I also don't like knowing that staff can't take care of themselves because they lack the technological expertise that they need. And much of the time they do so is because the staff pay has dropped so dramatically over the years. And another great example of outside groups coming in is political groups. It was the Sunlight Foundation started finding deleted tweets and put them online, then Twitter came in and decided to do it with them. That's exciting. But again, it's in their third party having to do the job of what we should expect Congress to do for itself. And I'm going to stop around there. There are plenty of recommendations we can make, like bringing back OTA would be a really great example of bringing technological expertise back on the Hill outside of CRS. We could also continue to help out Tech Congress in new ways and helping them facilitate finding really great individuals to do great work within Congress. And then we could just maybe pay our staff more. The money's available. And if you are receiving an MRA, maybe buying the newest Canon DSLR or a more affordable Manila notebooks that I've seen in offices, that could have gone towards a staffer's budget for that year and you could have gotten in some really great individuals. So technology aside, the basics, the hardware, it's not great, but they have the hardware for reason because it's for security purposes. The Dell computers do actually sell a purpose, and whoever works for Dell, Dell's a great company. I highly promote you guys. But they run on 2004 technology, and for a reason. However, we should start looking outside what we can do hardware-wise and try to engage more with third parties and then maybe bring it internal into the Hill. And that's my long rant.
Great. Well, now is the part where we open it up for discussion. I think one particularly valuable topic for discussion, if there are Hill staffers here who might want to share some of the frustrations, or former Hill staffers who might want to share some of the frustrations that they've had being limited potentially by technology and doing their job, or ideas people have for other ways in which a little bit of investment in technology could really help Congress do a much better job at the fundamental questions of how do you understand policy and how do you govern and how do you relate to your constituents. I think those would be all valuable topics for conversation. So let me open it to folks here. Anybody?
It seems like this technology issue is a bit of a two-sided coin. And one side we've heard about is that there's things that the Congress is just not doing at all. And we should, if the coin's on the table, we should flip it up and see that side. And then on the other side, what I'm curious about is the great resources that Congress does have that are underutilized, right? So you have staffers who are like panning for gold in the dirty river on LIS when there's a Saudi Arabia of information right next to them, right? We've got Westlaw, LexisNexis, SSRN, right? Research dollars are killed for the access we have to staffers, and we don't use it at all. I don't really know if staffers do use it. So I'm curious to know what you all think about, in addition to just bringing better technology to the Hill and getting us thinking about this thing, how do we better leverage the technology and the data that we do have access to so that staffers can, in the meantime, be able to operate effectively with that data that's out there.
And also, can you introduce yourself for the group? And so everyone, when you ask a question, can you introduce yourself?
I'm Sam, I work for Senator Portman.
Thanks.
Can I take a swing at this? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, I was in the House and Senate, and I worked for CRS as well. So I think there is a lot of information that's available, but as we know from a staffer perspective, you don't often have the time, or you rarely, if ever, have the time to digest it. And that's where a lot of the legislative support agencies can come to play, as well as the committees to a lesser extent. So, for example, and maybe there are other former CRS folks who may disagree with this perspective, but imagine, so right now, your typical person at CRS spends a lot of time answering phone calls, emails, and this lesser but significant amount of time writing the reports. Imagine if there was a daily or weekly newsletter that CRS put out on, I don't know, the 50 or 60 issues that are inside the, you know, that the Library of Congress. So let's say national security. So you have a person there who once a day or once a week says, here's all the hearings that are happening. Here's all the markups that are happening. Here's the bills that are moving. Here's the latest reporting from the press and a summary thereof. Here are the latest papers. And here's the court stuff that's happening this week, right? So leveraging those resources to give people situational awareness is very useful. Or moving it to a technological perspective, I'm working on this bill. I want to know if there are other similar related bills that have existed in the last couple of years on this topic and what happened to them. Or not this bill, but there was a committee report on a previous version of this bill from two Congresses ago. Or maybe it wasn't a committee report. Maybe there was a GAO report that was attached to the committee report, and I want to see that. So this is something that is actually solvable technologically, right? It is possible, if you wanted to, you could pull on a bill and see related bills. From the related bills, you could see the related committee hearings. The related committee hearings, you could also see the support agency. So this is something that you can, like, the technology exists to do this kind of thing. We just aren't doing it. So one aspect is leveraging personnel, right? Think about, are our legislative support agencies and are the committees providing information in a way that's useful that we can build these things on top of? And are doing analysis in a way that supports this contextualization? And with the technology that we, with the information that we already have, can we go and build on top of it these fairly lightweight tools that will also surface this kind of contextual information that you're looking for? I think that answers most of your question, but I'm happy to chat more, maybe these other things that have. Yeah,
I wanted to maybe take it a little different route in terms of, like, I don't think staffers are entirely aware of, like, how to do research on the federal government, and I think Congress could be a little better about that training. And I'm talking, like, just knowing what resources are out there, how to navigate the procurement process and understand where the money is flowing and the difference between all those source systems. Understanding the legislative branch agencies like GPO, how to navigate that website, portal there, GAO, how to grab the right audits and reports that are there in CRS as a research tool. But you can also take it further and kind of understanding when you're fielding government affairs people coming in and, you know, asking for their stuff and bills. I worked as a lobbyist for 5 years. I think some of the most mutually beneficial relationships were where staff understood that as industry representatives, we could do a lot of research for them and provide kind of survey views of stuff. So, you know, you can rely on that outside stakeholder base to do a lot of heavy analysis that you rightly would want to, you know, kind of compare across and, you know, not make sure you're just taking it as truth. But that's like another resource that I think is underutilized by overworked staff. And I would also kind of comment, you know, the comment was made about, you know, being confusing to constituents that every, you know, member office has a different website. Well, that's because, you know, every member is kind of in committee is like their own little small business. You know, they have kind of authority over their IT. So, and that kind of comes from the fact that the legislative branch has much looser acquisition rules. So you can acquire tech a little easier than maybe a federal bureaucracy, executive branch. But understanding that, like, there's tons of stuff out there that you can work to get and bring into, you know, up your analysis. So.
Can you introduce yourself?
I'm Alex Lay. I'm from the Made in Order Corporation. I have a question. I wonder if I might be able to kind of restate your question. I wonder, it seemed like what you were asking is, why can't we use proprietary tools like Westlaw or other research tools? I guess I wonder, like, how do you guys see the sort of trade-off between, like, investing in sort of internal, like, open data initiatives to sort of build a foundation for existing applications versus, you know, using kind of what already exists in the private market and doing partnerships with existing sort of private.
Go first, sir. Can we do it? You want to take it first, man?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. You go.
Yeah, I think there's a perfect balance that we're working with right now, building Open Gov Foundation. We're building free and open source software. That's one of our core values. But we certainly have not discredited any of these proprietary tools. Definitely, and you guys can agree here, we have to work with each other to make sure that what we're building, you know, on the inside is going to be compatible with those tools. So I don't see that there's a clear break or one or the other. It's a both and for us.
Yeah, I want to take a shot at this. No, yeah. Go first. Okay. So I think it depends on what it is. So for example, the constituent management tools cost about $50,000 per congressional office. Oh, I'm sorry. Do you want to say that? So if it's $50,000 per office times 535 offices, that's a lot of money. And offices generally are unhappy with their CRMs. They're often very unhappy, and they feel locked in. And they don't develop what they need, and they're not responsive. Part of it's because the market is too small. They would say the marketplace is too small, so they don't have the time to, you know, it's not worth the investment for them. But if you take that money and you pool it and you do and you say, okay, all these offices, instead of we're going to all do our own thing and like pay $50,000 a year, if we go and we have an office that does this kind of thing, well, maybe you're going to end up with like really cruddy stuff, but maybe you're going to end up with stuff that isn't. Or if you open up the marketplace so that people can build the, you know, open source versions of these tools. There are other ways of getting there as well. And $50,000, so if you know, that's a junior staffer, unfortunately. So there are definitely savings that can come from this. Now, that's different from access to the entire legal corpus, you know, that you can get through Westlaw. Now, as a matter of theory, the Library of Congress should have this, right? The Library of Congress has the best library in the world. They have, you know, when the Eastern European countries escaped from communism, they wanted copies of what their old laws were. They went to the Law Library of Congress to get them, which is phenomenal. But the Library of Congress has not been a fountain of technological innovation over the last 20 or 30 years. Maybe things will change under the new librarian. They do have paid services. So as a staffer at the Library of Congress, you can go and use Westlaw or Lexis or any of the other tools that are available. Actually, one of the things I was most proud of when I worked at CRS was I managed to break the Library of Congress. Mm-hmm. There was a treaty that they didn't have, and I was very excited to be looking for an international telecommunications treaty that they didn't have. Like that was a rare circumstance for that kind of thing to happen. But generally speaking, if you're willing to dig for it, they have it there someplace. They just don't usually have it in a way that is readily accessible and usable to the vast majority of folks. And I think that interface of great repository of information, but really bad user experience is something that you know, which they try to paper over with people. You know, that's the kind of thing that we can address from a technological perspective. And Sasha, did you want
to? Oh, just a quick to small comment regarding Lexwell, Lexis. Not all offices have access to it, and some offices that do, they're very lucky. Those are very expensive services, and unless you have a chief of staff who wants you to seize the value in these services, you're not going to get them. So then you're stuck with, and I'm not going to say stuck, Pacer. Pacer to pay by download service. So I mean, it's really, when we say we have staffers have a plethora of information, I think you should count yourself lucky, Sam, that you have that plethora of information in front of you. Because not everyone's available.
Does have access to Library, to Westlaw, and LexisNexis.
The house is different, though.
Maybe the house is different.
Yeah.
But I'm just saying, like, it is out there. Like, I don't think it's all
there. It is out there. We just need to create more access to it. And not only that, these services are sometimes difficult to use. I have used Westlaw for 5 years of my career now, and I still don't figure out how to navigate quite well. So we need more education how to use the services as well, because they're great unless you know how to use the tools that you're provided. And sometimes educational courses also do cost money, and it's not always in the budget, remember.
And if I can just read Lee Drutman's mind. This is also an experience question, right? So if you've got someone who's been there for a couple, when you're engaging in oversight of someone, and it's you and you've been there for 3 years, and then they've come in with their, you know, three SESs and their 15 GS15s, right? Like, this is not a fair fight. And experientially, whether it's doing research, being able to, I mean, at the risk of stating the obvious, like to do any of those kinds of things, there's also a function of experience. And since we underpay congressional staff compared to the executive branch, let alone compared to the outside world, the consequence is that it's very hard for people to be there long enough to build up this kind of expertise to be able to make the best use of these services, not from any fault of their own, but just from the nature of the environment that we're putting them into.
That's exactly what I did. There are powerful tools out there, but people need to know how to use them. And I mean, this is a similar theme that we hit at when we had a discussion on government support agencies. And Hill from government support agencies here said, look, we have all these resources, but the folks on the Hill like don't even know how to ask us good questions. So you can have access to Westlaw or LexisNexis, but if you don't even know how to, if you don't have the experience to even know what you're looking for or know how to ask these questions, it doesn't matter.
And before we go over here, I just wanted to say that data, yes. More of the basic paperwork about how government does what it does and the data needs to be made available. I remember being in this ludicrous position at Congressional Research Service back when I worked there, wherein I was trying to find an amendment that had been offered in committee the previous day because I had a staffer who wanted to know what the amendment was about because it had been accepted. And I went to somebody who was more senior to me, and that person told me, check CQ, they probably have a PDF of it. And I thought, my lord, really? Because of this scarcity, this artificial scarcity, you had a company basically pop up to provide it. So my feeling is that if we have more and more, you know, as a democratic principle, having more and more of the data and the basic materials of governance available to everyone is important, but it also creates a market for those who want to create apps and other technological interfaces who can do things better, and we all benefit from that.
Yeah, my name is Chris Savoyan. I'm one of the new Tech Congress fellows. The Christian you described, each congressional office like a small business. When it comes to cybersecurity, most small businesses don't face nation-state threats. They may face threats from organized crime, but you know, the Chinese government isn't trying to hack into a small business in Arkansas. But the congressional offices do face nation-state threats, and as much as I love my colleagues and friends at EFF, and I'm a regular Signal user, using Signal is the first step, but it's not the last step, and a once-a-month training course isn't going to provide congressional staff with the resources they need to protect themselves from well-financed intelligence agencies. This is not a cheap problem to solve, but it's an important problem. And I don't have the solution. I'm coming to Congress to try and help to be that solution. But I'm terribly worried that as long as we have 535 offices with their own single IT person, we're hosed. I don't know how you secure a member's iPhone or iPad or the email communications or the text message communications when you're facing such well-funded adversaries. I'm wondering if any of the panelists have any non-depressing thoughts on that topic.
Yeah, so I have some non-depressing thoughts, and I have a bunch of really depressing thoughts on it as well. What some people call cyber and others call the cyber, which is also entertaining. So to start, certainly on the House side and the Senate does it a little bit differently, and there are people here from relevant committees of jurisdiction or offices that I'm not going to point to, but that also in this room could talk about these things. So, the House's mail system is centralized. So Committee on House Administration and others, like, there is a apparatus that they use. I mean, they know they're under attack all the time. And actually a coworker of mine when I was at Sunlight worked for the Senate office that was doing a lot of these things. It isn't just office by office protection. There are institutional efforts to protect these kinds of things. That being said, there's like really obvious failings. So there was the hacking of like all of the members of Congress's phone numbers and email addresses. And if, well, the depressing number of members are still using AOL for their personal email accounts. And of course, one of the first factors that you look at is if you can't come through the front door, you come in through the side door. And if people are conducting things through GChat or through other mechanisms, you can't be having people not using two-factor authentication for their personal stuff. And they shouldn't be using like really cruddy, unprotected email accounts to do those kinds of things. But there, you know, there are many, many threats to Congress, you know, to Congress. It's not just from foreign intelligence agencies. We've seen it from domestic intelligence agencies. What happened with the Senate Intelligence Committee being spied on by the U.S. government was and continues to be a big problem. It says a lot about Congress's ability to go and use outside servers for a lot of its work. So, for example, one of the reasons that all of you are stuck with awful Outlook, I think Outlook is awful, maybe all of it, but like you can't use server, like GSA, for example, uses Gmail. They use a business version of Gmail. But for protection of the communications, to keep them protected under speech or debate clause and to do all the other things that are necessary, there are really smart reasons why they're keeping a lot of that stuff internal to Congress, which means that you have less capable tools that are available because they're trying to protect it more securely. So there is definitely a very difficult balance between security and utility. And I don't think that we're necessarily striking it right for a lot of the things that we're doing. This isn't like the fault of anybody, like any, there isn't like someone you could say like you're doing this wrong, but sort of generally speaking, it's the institution is bad at grappling with these kinds of problems. And I hope that since you'll be here as a tech fellow, you can help think through at least some of these kinds of questions.
So. Yeah, and I was more talking about getting access for staff or kind of analysis tools on public sector, you know, publicly available data. Less, you know, I wasn't talking about storage, communications, that
kind
of infrastructure.
So there may be centralized mail and there may be a centralized web server, but the offices run their own computers and they are responsible for their own laptops and cell phones. And so you may have centralized management of the network and of the servers, but the endpoint devices that can be compromised with malware are run by the offices.
Well, the phones are central. There's a central phone office. It has a different name, but whatever. There's a central office that handles. I believe it covers mobile as well as fixed line. So that is being centrally managed. I can't speak to the computers are purchased through the individual offices. I don't know. I don't have enough knowledge to speak of whether like how the protection mechanism is employed to make them hardened. So I can't talk to that. Maybe somebody else can. We're getting sort of at the edge of what I can usefully talk about.
introduce yourself.
Yeah, Travis Moore. I run Tech Congress, policing these fine folks in congressional offices. If you have ideas for their placement, come talk to them after. The question, you know, I started Tech Congress because I was represented by Waxman's LD and found that there were very few people that were trying to help the institution operate more effectively. I think, you know, you among them and people in this room are those constituencies. I guess when you talk to Todd Park and Megan Smith in the administration, they say that their success was directly driven by the fact that they had air cover from their principal, from the president. And that was in part because there was a strong constituency, people trying to sign up for healthcare, that needed those services. I guess for Congress, my question is, who are the constituencies outside of this room that have an interest in seeing the institution function better that we're not tapping into, and whether, given the political environment we're walking into, can help unleash those. But who are the constituencies that we should be bringing into this?
I hate
everyone.
Like low hanging fruit. So there are people who recognize themselves as constituencies for these, and there are people who don't. So, like, theoretically, any American who wants to communicate with Congress is someone who should care about this kind of thing. As a practical matter, people don't think about things in that kind of way, so what you end up with is business associations and trade associations that care about this, a lot of, like, sort of like what I help represent, it's like outside civil society cares about this kind of thing. There's a whole bunch of academics of varying, you know, that care about this kind of stuff. There's a bunch of policy people, sort of the influence industry inside DC, that has an interest in, to some extent, of this being better. To some extent, they have an interest in it not being better, right? There's preservation of the position that they're in. I mean, I think and we have seen people inside Congress, including leadership, have real problems with these things as well. I think a lot of what's holding it back, I think three main things are what's holding this back. One is the budget cutting that's taken place. And the budget cutting is this notion of, you know, government is bloated and we're going to demonstrate our parsimonious by cutting in Congress. So that's like the first, you know, so if Congress says, like they should, when they look at the budget process in a couple months, you know, they should probably increase funding for Congress by 10%, right? Or something, somewhere in that 5%, somewhere in that order of magnitude to restore, you know, somewhere in that range, maybe like that would be a thing. But what happens if Congress increases the amount of money for staffers? Well, we've all written on this. I can't tell you the number of like really nasty communications that I got when I say, well, maybe we should pay people kind of what they're worth. But that's sort of an institutional thing that's pushing against it. The second is a lack of centralization. So the UK has a central committee, which sounds vaguely Soviet, but it's not. They have a central entity that is responsible for technology inside the House and the House of Lords and the House of Commons. That manages like institution-wide. Here we have Community House Administration and Senate Rules and Legislative Probe Subcommittee in the House and in the Senate, and you've got leadership, and then you've got Library of Congress and its different factions and GP. You've got a whole bunch of folks, and there isn't a thing. So that while there is support to do this, there is a massive collective action problem. Like people just can't all fire on the right thing at the right time and agree, and it just doesn't function out. And the third piece is sort of what you've identified, which is that we all benefited from this, but there's a tragedy of the commons problem, which is that, yes, it'd be really great to like communicate with your congressman and get a response back quickly and have them make really good policy and see what they're doing and engage in appropriate oversight on issues that like you've never thought of. But there isn't like the major countervailing forces are, there's this fight on this bill right now. Like we're going to fight on ACA right now. We're going to have that fight this week, and that's what's going to predominate. And people aren't going to see the underlying structural problems. So we end up with what we see now is that people hate Congress. They hate government generally, but they hate Congress particularly. And it's a really hard problem. The way, sorry, I'm going to shut up in just a sec, but the way we try to solve it, and you are as well, which is look for those pivot points, like those little things that if you move just like one little thing, that it makes a whole bunch of other things possible. And really playing very much an inside game. So yes, you are absolutely right. How do we identify outside constituencies? Journalists aren't going to engage on this kind of stuff. Some corporations, well, civil society, well. The vast majority of American people are just going to be like, this place is awful, we should burn it to the ground, and they're not going to engage with the question of why it's not functioning right. That's a really depressing answer. Maybe someone has a less depressing
answer. Can I just push back on this question about journalists not engaging? Because, I mean, I think part of this is that all of us who believe in government capacity haven't done enough to actually tell the story to journalists, right? The typical journalist story is Congress is corrupt and we're going to find out all the ways in which Congress is corrupt. But I think there's another narrative that all of us who care about this need to get out there and say, which is there's a reason that Congress has a hard time functioning, and it's fundamentally an institutional legislative capacity story. And if you want to have a really interesting story to tell, you know, write the story about the 24-year-old staffer who doesn't understand the first thing about healthcare and is trying to figure out how to fix the healthcare system.
Yeah, I think that's throw in on the journalism question. I mean, my own read is that there's places like Federal Computing Week, Government Executive, where they will cover gov tech stuff in a serious way, and you get other places that'll pop up in Wired and that sort of stuff. But I don't think it's kind of a regular beat, and it's almost as if it's tech journalists writing for a tech community. And so the sort of stuff that pops up in the Washington Post is not going to be a happy story or necessarily a nuanced story. It's going to be like, oh, here's this defense IT system which cost a bazillion dollars and doesn't work. And that's the sort of stuff you get. And I don't know if that's just the way the, you know, yeah, the structure of the media and the sorting out of the journalists are involved or what.
You exercise this.
You. Sorry, Daniel.
No, here, you need a mic.
They're really great real-world examples of questions of hearings, for example. I remember when I first started Hill, I thought I had to write every single question my member had said and had it perfectly crafted, and I had to read all the materials, and I came in wide-eyed and bushy-tailed, and I did do that for several months, and then people started making fun of me and going, why are you at the office at 8, 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock at night, and get in at 5 o'clock in the morning? Why don't you just call X company and have them provide you with options to say? And when you talk to constituents like that, like maybe there's a knowledge devoid with staffers in certain areas, they're so overworked, they're covering so many different topics. They have the time to have expertise in one area, but another area they don't, but they have to know all about it within 2 days. Congressional hearing just been announced. You have to wonder how the lobbying groups are then coming in and infiltrating. And when you say that to a constituent going, well, I say the drain, the swamp, that's the swamp. And the swamp isn't paying staffers more. It's actually trying to educate them. And by draining, you mean you should probably be lifting your staff up. Because the only way you can drain a swamp, even in Trumpism, I'm really enjoying this Trumpism today, is by getting the I'm just going to stick this
down
real quick. It's by getting the lobby groups outside of the Hill and bringing in staff who are paid well enough to think for themselves, want to learn more, and consult with outside groups instead of literally cutting and pasting questions a company will send to them. That's very sad, and it's a secret, and I feel like I might have ruined a lot of people's days. But it's the truth.
Office. Thanks, everyone. This is awesome. I want to kind of connect to the ideas of product, specifically with the third-party software options. Mm-hmm. Daniel referenced this feature with A+. I use Evernote Premium because I don't have technology that I need. That's probably inappropriate, especially given what went on with third-party servers this year. I don't really have much of a choice, so I'm breaking the rules by doing that and opening myself up to probably some sort of access to my information in any legal setting. But Lee would probably like some entrepreneurship amongst staffers. So until we have a big software package or technological option for Congress to adopt as a body, people like me and Sam want to adopt individual records. So it's probably wrong for me to use Evernote or Google Drive, but for you all that are trying to create products for Congress, maybe there's a way to do that, that an individual staffer or an individual office can act laterally, and you can have some organic testing of this stuff. Because we did that this afternoon to do some sort of massive overhaul for our congressional adoption or acquisitions maybe longer down the road. So I would just encourage you to maybe discuss and offer solutions that a single staffer can adopt and begin planting the seeds, because I'd like to do that. I'm sure all the staffers in this room would like to do that. Yeah. And that catches fire with our colleagues who don't necessarily know better, but they learn from us. I currently fish with a spear because I've never seen a net. And that dictates how I fish. But if I had a net and knew how to use it, I would be fishing very differently. Yeah. And probably more effectively, and my member would be happier. So the constituency question is, I think the members are part of the constituency. They want me to be more effective. They don't know that a net exists. And I don't know that it exists. But you all can create nets.
Yeah. Awesome. I would say you're lucky that you're in the Senate, because last time I checked, Evernote was not available in the House.
Yeah.
I remember we were not able to even access it from the web. But so.
I'm looking for remedies.
No.
I believe Evernote Premium to use personally in the Senate.
Yeah, there's the Congressional Management Foundation, which I don't think we've talked about yet, working on a project, Congress 3.0. I suggest, if you haven't, look it up. When I was a staffer, I took down a systems map where we were using Google Drive, Slack, and all these other tools that I knew we couldn't use. And I said, can you please help me let other people know that these tools exist? They're doing really great work. You should check them out. But I do agree that when you have these 535 small businesses, we're all coming up with our own solutions. And there's definitely an opportunity for us to do more of that collaboration.
The irony is Google has 300 security engineers.
Yep.
So from a cybersecurity standpoint, these like proven Silicon Valley firms, your data is more secure there. That's not from a legal perspective, and you know, they can be held with appropriate processes and other stuff. But depending on what you're worried about, if you're worried about a court order, it's one thing. But if you're worried about someone breaking in, these firms are probably better than you know the hacked up solution that, that you might be running internally.
So just a couple of things. One, I'm going to pretend I didn't hear the Evernote thing. Probably, if you work on a committee, there's probably record keeping issues as well with that, in terms of rules regarding that. But it is not surprising. I mean, staff are doing what they need to do to survive. I can't tell you how many Google forms I fill out when I'm dealing with, you know, during appropriation season, which is entirely inappropriate. But I mean, there is no other way to humanly do it. Like that is the way you have to do it because there's no other way to get through. And this is in part trying to help Congress adapt to the way that people need to use their technology. There are limitations to what we on the outside can build and give at no cost because there's gift rule problems that you run into in the Senate that you don't run into in the same way in the House, even if it's open source. So there's like legal barriers, like another legal barrier, like the reason why you can't use Google has in part some to do with speech or debate clause protections, both keeping things outside the system and the concern that it can be intercepted, you know, not as a court order to use in legal proceeding, but so that other people can see it. The way the courts interpreted it may go outside of what is protected, what would or would not be protected communications from a member perspective, and that can be changed. Right, that's a bill. Right, you can change that through a law, but people don't think about it necessarily in that kind of way, and that's why people don't have Gmail. There may be other reasons. I don't want to look at some of the tech folks and people inside the you know the relevant offices in the House here, but there are maybe other reasons, but that is certainly one of those reasons. There may be a cost factor or something as well, although it's fairly inexpensive. There is a need to sort of map, like what you were talking about, what do people use, how do they actually you know engage in their workflow? But there's also what are people, what you've identified, all the workarounds. And we all have, you know, inside or outside, we all have workarounds to try to do these things. But where are the major pain points? And can we help member offices sort of work together to find solutions to these kinds of things? I mean, that's the endeavor in which we're all, you know, engaged with. But yeah, I mean, you make an excellent point.
So
introduce yourself.
I'm actually a reporter with FedSoup. So we're a small company that writes about federal IT. And the reason I just wanted to like introduce myself really quickly was the discussion earlier was about like, oh, no journalists cover this. And like, we're not interested in these stories. And I'm in fact very interested in these stories. And we cover executive branch type a lot. So we cover like 18F, USPS. What Defense Digital Services has been trying to do, stuff like that, like pockets of innovation, and how that's changed like IT systems in the executive branch. But we don't cover legislative as much, in part because it's really hard to figure out which of you guys are actually interested in talking to us, like who is willing to talk on the record, right? And so, again, I'm like here as a resource, and I'd love to talk to anybody who's interested in like, you know, telling the story. Because I know it's very like it's an ongoing problem that I've been interested in covering, but I haven't been able to get to the right people. So, yeah. Okay. What's up?
Excellent.
So yeah, to your point on that Google hires you know, several hundred security engineers. I'd postulate that the U.S. government also hires thousands of cybersecurity engineers and you know many other skills through their national lab programs. So you know the way that agencies, when they are behind in technological development, you know they go to Congress and they say, "Hey, Congress, you know can you appropriate some amount of money to build a research lab to help bolster all our technology in this area?" And you know in a way. Those labs are both, they care about this conversation because they, you know, provide technical services, but they're also, you know, downstream recipients of the funds because ultimately the agencies have to solve the problems and the agencies go to the labs. So I've always been kind of curious, why aren't the labs part of this conversation? Because they both have the technical expertise and, you know, the incentive to be here.
Good question. I wish I knew.
I mean, some of it is the relevant communities of jurisdiction. So, like, we've talked to NIST set standards for encryption. And that's come into conversation around efforts by the intelligence agencies to undermine NIST setting of strong encryption. Some of this is coming into play. And there is conversation. I mean, I can't talk. Now we're, like, at the edge of, like, where I can say anything useful, right? There is coordination, I believe, between efforts to protect Congress and efforts to protect the other branches. Like, it's not like wholly separate, but there are also institutional prerogatives that need to be protected because of the the structure of our federal government, and competing interests, as we saw with the example of the hacking into the Senate Intelligence Committee. And we had other problems, like there was an issue in one of the Judiciary Committees where Democrats got into Republican server, Republicans got into Democrat server. I don't remember what the story was, but there are those kinds of things. Yes, there's some conversation. It's not at the level, at least that I can see, to make a useful evaluation of it. So maybe others can speak to it more, but that's like the limit of what I can say.
I have one final question.
Yeah, so we're talking about a whole range of issues here, and I wonder, has there been any thought? I know there's a proposal for committee on the reorganization of Congress that comes up every 20 years. It doesn't look like that's going to happen, you guys tell me. But
probably not this Congress.
not at the moment.
How do you begin to create a set of recommendations, if it's 10 or if it's 110, that the institution could be acting on? And so you've got this forum here.
Yeah.
Could there be a task force on congressional technology? Should we advocate for the Committee on House Administration to have a subcommittee specific to technology infrastructure to study these issues, I guess? Like, what's the sort of tangible next step? Should we be looking to funders to try and fund one of the institutes that looks at Congress to do a series of long-form research on these things? Like, what's a tangible next step that we can sort of bring together to try and really capture, like, dozens and dozens of issues?
So this is what the Congressional Data Coalition does. We make recommendations on a regular basis to what Congress is doing. We're actually working on the most recent set for the clerk's office at their request. So in the past, we've recommended things like, one, there should be a central place, right? Chief technology officer, chief open data officer, chief data officer, like whatever you want to call it. There needs to be a person or a set of people that focus solely on this, that look at it from a branch-wide perspective, and can help offices and members and committees and others, support agencies, like, think through this set of problems. So if you're on the outside and you want information, this is who you talk to. If you're on the inside and you're trying to figure out how to do something, this is who you talk to. So that's one. The second is increasing the budget, right? We're gonna have two budget resolutions this year, which is fairly unusual. The first one is too late to influence, but the second one, there should be more money flowing to Congress, generally speaking. And some of that money should be flowing towards this set of technology questions. So coordinating it. So the third is that there's an advisory committee on the records of Congress. I don't know if anyone's ever heard of it. They meet twice a year. You've heard of it.
January and December.
Yep, January and December. So it's, and they were created in like 1993, 1994, 1998 to look at the records of Congress. And this is an advisory group of people. I've been to the meetings of like academics who are expert in the subject matter. There should be something similar to that, that talks like an advisory committee on the technology of Congress. You know, that brings in outside groups, that meets on a regular basis, that serves to advise. We created the Congressional Data Coalition in part to play that role. But it's not, because in part we know that Congress deals very well with a thing. So we create a thing so that there would be a thing for them to talk to, right? We have like a sort of semi, we have a de facto role of doing that kind of thing. But it shouldn't just be like the 60-something people that have assembled, right? That's not the right approach. It should be Congress thinking thoughtfully about the different like areas of representation and having a process to have folks come in and structure it like a regular advisory committee that has regular engagement with the relevant components inside Congress. Like that is so a person in an office that's responsible, enough money to do these kinds of things, an office that helps structure the kind of engagement that's coming in, which is the advisory committee. And then, of course, we all have, like, I've got a list of, like, 50 things that would be useful things to do with that. I won't, but they're all examples of that kind of stuff. And probably, finally, so when I was at Sunlight, we created the advisory committee on transparency that did some of the work here of, like, sort of bringing folks together. We've had the emergence of this group in the last year or so that helps do that kind of thing as well. You know, this is a resource question for outside organizations, as you know better than just about anyone, to do this kind of work. But from a civil society and like corporate perspective, we need to do more of these kinds of things. We need to help staffers sit down and meet each other. You know, 10 years ago when we did the open house project, we had all these meetings for like people inside Congress and people outside and help them build these connections. We haven't done that since. And that would be something that would be useful to do, but that is a capacity problem. So if I were to like boil the list down to four things, those would probably be the four things that would be the most logical next steps. Well, we and of course the Joint Committee on the Operations of Congress, which probably isn't happening in the near term.
Well, we've hit 1:20 now, and we have the room till 1:30, but we're going to wrap up the formal program here. I think your question is a really good one, and maybe anyone who wants to hang around and brainstorm about how we can move the ball forward, that would be worthwhile, because obviously there's a lot of folks on the outside and there's some folks on the inside of Congress who are concerned about this issue. The question is, how do you get this disaggregated entity known as Congress to actually take it up in a more substantial way? And figuring that out would be fun to talk about. So thank you all for coming today, and keep your eye on ledgebranch.com for the announcement for the next meeting.
And thanks to our panelists.